It's difficult to introduce someone who needs no introduction, and judging from the audience, Dr. Brooks needs no introduction. Arthur C. Brooks is president of the American Enterprise Institute. He's also the Beth and Ravenel Curry Scholar in Free Enterprise at the Institute. Immediately before this assignment, he was the Lewis A. Bantle Professor of Business and Government at Syracuse University, where he taught economics and social entrepreneurship. He's the author of 10 books and hundreds of articles on topics including the role of government, fairness, economic opportunity, happiness, and the morality of free enterprise. His latest book, The Road to Freedom, How to Win the Fight for Free Enterprise, was a New York Times bestseller. Among his earlier books are Gross National Happiness, Social Entrepreneurship, and Who Really Cares? Before pursuing his work in public policy, he spent 12 years as a classical musician in the United States and Spain. He's a frequent guest on national television and radio talk shows and has been published widely in publications including the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post. He has a PhD and an MPhil in policy analysis from Rand Graduate University. He also holds an MA in economics from Florida Atlantic University and a BA from Thomas Edison State College. I also understand he's going to share a very important secret with us today. It is 3 secrets to a happier life. Dr. Brooks.
Thank you, Richard. Thanks to all of you. What an honor to be back here at BYU. This is really one of my favorite places to go to, and not just because it's the most beautiful place in America. It's just truly one of the happiest places in America. I've been looking at data on the subject of happiness for years and years, and you know, it starts to get boring when you see the same statistics over and over again. And I've been looking at the rankings of U.S. states on happiness, on happiness that's defined as how well do you think your life is going. In anonymous surveys and in very large samples, and you find again and again, it's always Utah. Huh. You guys got some sort of secret. And furthermore, when you get to give lectures on happiness in the place in Utah called Happy Valley, well, there's an expression for that. It's called bringing coals to Newcastle. So I'm not exactly sure that I'm gonna teach you anything you don't know today, but I'm hoping that maybe I can give you a couple of tips that you can pass on to somebody else. This is the 3 secrets to a happier life. Now, why am I going to talk about this subject? I've been writing about happiness for years and years. I've studied it. I've written books on the subject. And the funniest thing is that I notice every time I give a speech on happiness, particularly to business people, at least one person that's really successful, really big money earner, comes up to me afterward and says, give me some practical tips on how to be happier. Okay, they want real advice, not just statistics. They want some advice on how to be happier. And I tell them 3 secrets, and these are the 3 secrets that I'm going to give you today. Okay, now, when somebody says to you, I want to be happier, what are they really saying? They're actually really saying, I want to be less unhappy. It's always the case. I mean, nobody says, I need advice on being happy if they're not unhappy. And happiness and unhappiness are actually very different phenomena. Brain scientists find that unhappiness and happiness are processed in different hemispheres of the brain, as a matter of fact. So if I'm going to give somebody some good advice, I really needed to talk not about happiness, I need to talk about unhappiness. And that's where I want to start our journey here today. I want to talk to you a little bit about what we know about who's unhappy and why they are unhappy. Okay, so a little bit of data for you. Large surveys, anonymously conducted, year after year, you find that between 10 and 15% of the population is honestly unhappy about their life. A third of Americans are very happy. That's, you know, you. 55% or so are somewhat happy about their lives, and the rest, 10 to 15%, are unhappy about their lives. This year, right now, the latest survey shows 13% of Americans are unhappy. Now, part of this is a clinical problem. 3% of Americans are chronically clinically depressed, which is a psychiatric medical problem, and I'm not going to deal with that. I want to talk about the other 10 percentage points of Americans who don't have a medical problem, but nonetheless, they're just not very happy with the way their life is going. See, those are the guys who are coming up to me after speeches going, can I get some advice on how I can just be a little bit happier? Because they're not happy enough. So what do I tell them? Well, first of all, let's think a little bit, because there's a big literature out there from social psychologists about the sources of basic unhappiness. You've all felt it. We've all been unhappy from day to day, and you know people who are kind of unhappy about their lives. What explains this? What are the basic categories of unhappiness? Okay? The first is just aggravations, the stuff you don't like, the things you have to put up with, right? And it turns out that there are some studies on this about what aggravates people the most. Why do I want to tell you about that? I want to tell you about that because you can fix some of those things if you've got some knowledge. So I'm going to give you some practical tips here in a second. The second category of things that make people happy are the persistent circumstances that are a lot harder to change, circumstances in people's lives. And the last is the most existential. It's dissatisfaction. And that's where I really want to spend my time today, about dissatisfaction in people's lives. Okay, so let's start off by talking about aggravation. What is it about people's lives from day to day that makes them aggravated, okay? That brings them down, that makes them a little less happy? I mean, you can think about the things in your life that do it. I can think about the things in my life that do it. But there's this one great study I have to tell you about. It was conducted by a social psychologist at Princeton named Daniel Kahneman. He's actually the only non-economist to ever win the Nobel Prize in economics. He's a social psychologist, a brilliant guy. Okay, now, Daniel Kahneman had this theory, and his theory was people don't actually know what makes them happy or unhappy from a day-to-day and a minute-to-minute basis. Not because they're not going to lie to you about it. It's just that they don't really remember. We have selective memories. The reason he thought this is that he's a father, and he remembered when his kids were little, and he knew, thinking back on it, he thought, actually, when they were day-to-day and minute-to-minute, they never made me very happy. Right? That was kind of made me unhappy. But I think back and I go, oh, I love my kids. Right? And so he said, I wonder if you ask people from minute to minute, they're going to give you different answers about what's aggravating them. And okay. So he did a study. And how did he do it? This was about 15 years ago. And he bought a bunch of devices. They were, you'd never heard of these things if you're students. They're called Palm Pilots. Right? They're called Palm Pilots, right? Now they're called doorstops, right? And these Palm Pilots, they're little PDAs, they were really cutting edge in those days. And he bought a few hundred of them with a grant. And he induced people to participate in this experiment by saying, if you do this study, you get to keep the Palm Pilot. Cool, right? And everybody's like, yeah, I want the Palm Pilot, which was useful for like a month afterward. And they strapped on the Palm Pilots, and every 15 minutes, the thing would go ding. And they'd pull out the Palm Pilot, and they had to write down, what am I doing right now, and how happy am I, or how unhappy am I? Okay? That was a kind of an interesting study. And he found out, in order, what are the most aggravating, unhappiness-provoking activities in which people spend their days doing. Okay? Now, and they didn't know it turns out. It was a big surprise to people. So I know, and I'm about to tell you, the most single unhappiness-provoking activity in the average person's day. What do you think it is? What do you think it is? Somebody throw it out. Yes, sir.
Is it like watching TV?
Watching TV is pretty high up in happiness, believe it or not. People really enjoy watching TV, which is crazy because there's like nothing on, right? So, it's paradoxical. Actually, it's a reflection on your good character that you voted that way, and I commend you for it. Yes, ma'am. Traffic, good. Traffic's number two. Traffic's number two, okay? This is the number two aggravation-provoking thing is sitting in traffic. And I can tell you, I live in Washington, D.C., and, actually, there's a lot in Washington, D.C. After I'd been there for 5 years, somebody was asking my wife, neither one of us is from Washington, right? And somebody's asking my wife, do you like Washington? And she said, you know, it's really great, except for the traffic and the weather and the people, right? So what else? What do you think is number one? Yeah.
Hunger.
Well, most people don't feel hunger, so probably it would be. That's probably good if I had enough sample on people who are truly that destitute, particularly outside the United States. So that one doesn't quite count because I don't have that in the data. Okay. All right, one more. Waking up. Yeah, I can tell something about you. All right, so, and here's what it was. You ready for it? The number one unhappiness-provoking activity in the average day is spending time with your boss. Oh, man. Now, I really took this one to heart. Why? Because I'm a boss. I'm the president of the American Enterprise Institute. I have 206 full-time employees, right? And, you know, I read this study. It's very disheartening. And I used to think when I go into the lunchroom and I sit down that people kind of go silent because out of respect, right? It turns out it's depression. I'm eating lunch alone now. For their sake. Okay, so there's a lot of aggravation. Now, if you want to see the study, talk to me afterward, and you can get the paper. You can get it online, and you can look at the list of things. What do? Number one, try to control your destiny a little bit better. Do fewer of these things. It turns out there's a lot that you can do less of. The main mistake that people make when they get out of college with a really good degree, you know what they do? They say, I am going to get a job that will pay so I can get a really nice house, but I'm going to have to live far away, but that's okay, because I'll get used to the commute. No, you won't. Right? No, you won't. You'll get used to the house, you'll get used to the money after about 6 months. You'll never get used to the commute. Don't do it. Don't do it. You'll learn stuff like this from this literature. You can improve your life by getting rid of aggravations. Now, there are other circumstances, however, that are hard to fix. There are circumstances that make life really a chore, and maybe hunger goes into that category, if we had data on that. But here's the big one in ordinary people's lives. Here's the big one. Loneliness. There's a psychologist at the University of Chicago named John Cacioppo. He's the world's leading expert on the subject of human loneliness. And what he finds is really shocking. He finds that 20% of Americans report anonymously that loneliness is a big source of unhappiness in their lives. Look around you. 1 in 5 of you actually suffers from some sort of loneliness. Now, it gets more interesting. These are not just hermits who live way out and with no neighbors, right? Most of these people who are lonely have pretty active social lives. There's just something that's not right. So dig down a little further. Let's think about loneliness a little bit more. Who are the loneliest people in America? The answer is middle-aged men. Middle-aged men, okay? You're going to look at your professors a little bit differently now, aren't you? Right? Middle-aged men. Why? Why? And we know the reason for that, too. The reason is a lack of real friendships. See, here's kind of how the story goes. When you're in a typical nuclear family, where dad's going to work really long hours, particularly when he's supporting a young family, and if mom works either fewer hours or is staying home with the children, right, the friendships change a lot. I mean, I can tell you, because, you know, I got a house full of teenagers, which is, you know, super fun. And when, you know, I've had kids in the family for a long time. And, you know, you go to work and you have colleagues, you have relationships with people that are social, but it's not the same thing as the friendships that you had when you were in college, right? You're not going to go out and hang out and have a bite to eat after work with these people because that's robbing your family. So the result is you become very good at being well socialized, but you get worse and worse and worse at actually having friends. Friendship is a skill. Friendship is like a muscle, and you have to work on the muscle to keep it good and strong. Now, women, on the other hand, typically, particularly if they're taking care of children, have more active social lives and are better at keeping up friendships. So what do you find? Men are lonelier and lonelier and lonelier, and women are less and less and less lonely. Here's the only statistic you need to know. At age 60, what percentage of men say their best friend is their wife? Answer? 60%. 60% of your dads say, my best friend is your mom, right? What percentage of their wives say their best friend is their husband? 30%. 30%. That's kind of sad, isn't it? That's the story I'm trying to tell. Loneliness is a big problem in people's lives. So what do you need to know to take away from that big takeaway? Don't fall into the trap, especially you guys. Hold on to your friendships. These are very dear. Don't lose the skill. Goes for you ladies, too, by the way. Okay, so those are two categories, aggravations and circumstances, and I could go into a whole lecture on either one of them, but I want to get to the big one, the big one. Number three, if you ask people, what's the problem? Talk to people who are sad. What's the problem? ordinarily, they can't quite put their finger on it. It's kind of weird. Try it sometime. They'll say, something's missing. There's not enough of something in their lives. I mean, they can come up with some sort of lame excuse, etc., but it seems like there's this hole in their lives. They're dissatisfied with the way things are going. You know, it felt like things were going to turn out differently, right? I thought that my marriage was going to turn out differently. I thought that my job was going to turn out differently. There's kind of a malaise about people who are constantly sad about their lives. There's a dissatisfaction with the way that life is turning out. Try it sometime. Ask somebody who's got these types of issues, and you'll hear this. So here's the question. For people who feel this, how do they fill the hole? How do they satisfy the dissatisfaction, typically? Well, we know how. You know how they do it? They do it with four things. Fame, power, pleasure, and money. Those are the big ones. Now, philosophers have been talking about this for thousands of years. St. Thomas Aquinas, the most important saint in the Roman Catholic Church, one of the most important from the 12th century, said that people are dissatisfied. Why? Because they're actually looking for substitutes for what? For God. They're looking for substitutes for God. And it says it comes in four categories: money, power, pleasure, and honor. Sounds familiar, right? Except when he said honor, what he meant was fame in the way that we talk about it today. So here's my question to you. If that's true, if people are always looking for something and dissatisfied, and they're always looking for fame and power and physical pleasure and money, why do they do that? Why do they think that those are going to actually be the substitutes, the things that they really are seeking? Why do they think they're going to get happiness from those things? And the answer is, because that's what the world tells them is going to work. Think about it. There's a reason that you don't like TV. The reason. Because it gives you inadequate substitutes for what you seek, right? Because it gives you the bad stuff all the time. There's a reason that your parents never took you to R-rated movies, and that I won't, and I don't even see those movies, right? The values are no good. There's a reason you're suspicious of a lot of the media. There's a reason that most universities, not this one, there's a reason that most universities are creating bad values. It's because they're sending the message to people all across the country. You want to be happier? I'll tell you what you need. Fame, pleasure, money. You know, the world has a formula to relieve dissatisfaction. The worldly formula for happiness. You know what it is? Love things and use people. That's the formula of the world. Now, you think about it, you see it all day long. Love that. Buy this, you'll be happy. This is great, this physical thing. Make some more money, everything will be fine. And people, use them for your satisfaction temporarily. Step on them for your fame and for your ambition. Love things and use people. That's the worldly formula. It's simple, it's elegant, and it's wrong. And I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to give you evidence that it's wrong. And then I'm going to tell you what the real formula is. Okay, so let's focus on one of those things. We don't have time to talk about everything. If you want, you know, in the Q&A, we can talk about fame. I have data on fame, believe it or not. It's pretty interesting. I have data on pleasure. Pretty interesting, too. But I want to talk about money. I'm interested in money. I'm an economist. I think money is an interesting thing. Why not? Because it just buys a bunch of stuff. Because it makes people act in particular ways. It's a really big driver of behavior. So let's talk about money and let's ask a very simple question. Okay? Can money buy happiness? Your mother said no, right? The church says no. What do the data say? The data say yes. Money can buy happiness. No, no, wait. I'm not trying to subvert your mother. Your mother's wiser than I am. But we know that money can buy happiness if you're poor. How is that? Well, the problem with being poor in the United States in particular is that it brings pressure to make decisions that people shouldn't have to make. A decision: should I buy medicine or food? Should I have my electricity turned off or my water turned off? These are terrible decisions to make, particularly when you have children, okay? If you can relieve the necessity of making these decisions, you will raise people's happiness. Money buys happiness if you're truly poor, but only if you're truly poor. Okay? That's not what your mother was talking about. She was talking about you, and your mother's right about you. Once you get above the level of poverty, once you get above the level of subsistence, money doesn't bring happiness at all. Many studies show this, that above the level of lower middle class life, you can add money and add money and add money, and you're not going to be bringing any more happiness. Right? So that's one of the big things that we find. And furthermore, it gets worse. Money's not neutral. People who seek money for the sake of money tend to make themselves progressively unhappier and unhappier. Don't fall into this pattern. Psychologists at the University of Rochester in 2009, they surveyed, studied, and interviewed 147 graduates. Okay, now what do? Graduating seniors, they asked them before they left about their goals in life. What do you want? What do you want? I'm going to come back in 5 years and ask you whether or not you hit your goals, but you got to tell me what your goals are right now, okay? So think about your own goals. Think about what you really would like to see about yourself 5 years after you graduate from college, okay? When you're 29 years old or something, right? Who do you want to be? What do you want to have achieved? Okay, now they found that the goals of the people who were graduating from the University of Rochester, that their goals fell into two kind of categories, intrinsic goals and extrinsic goals. Intrinsic goals were all about relationships. I want to have a happy marriage. I want to have children and a good loving relationship with them. I want to be true to my God. These are the kinds of things that people who had intrinsic goals said about their lives. And about half of them said that, believe it or not. That's good to know. The other half had extrinsic goals that were all about, I want to be respected and well seen by my peers, or I want to make a lot of money. Okay? Fame and money. So either you're talking about relationships that are well ordered with people and God, or you're talking about the extrinsic stuff in life, which is largely about fame, power, and money. Okay, so what did they find? They went back in 5 years, and there are two big takeaways from the study. Number one, the good news. You hit your goals. You're going to hit your goals. That's the good news. It's not like people said, I really wanted these things, but it didn't work out. We kind of think that might be the case. It's not the case. You're going to hit your goals. That's what the data clearly say. But here's the bad news. If you have the wrong kind of goals, it's going to be pretty unsatisfactory for you. People who had intrinsic goals were well-adjusted and generally very happy. People who had extrinsic goals had, I quote, shame and anger, headaches, stomach aches, and loss of energy. If you said, I want to get rich, 5 years later, you probably will be well on your way and you're going to be pretty miserable about it. The problem here is not exactly making the money. The problem is the intention of making the money and dedicating your life to these types of extrinsic goals. Science is clear on this, but of course, you don't need the science, right? Because religion has always taught us this. Ecclesiastes 5:10, whoever loves money never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. This too is meaningless. Or this, before ye seek for riches, this is the second chapter of the book of Jacob, seek ye for the kingdom of God. Get it right. Intrinsic first, extrinsic second. Now, this is not just Christianity that says this. I spend a lot of time, I have a great collaboration with the Dalai Lama. Right? We're talking about the morality of free enterprise. We're talking about the big issues in life. We do this twice a year, right? And so I'm very interested in what the Buddhists have to say about this. And listen to this. There's a word in Sanskrit, in the Sanskrit language. It's called upadana. What does it mean? Upadana is the sticky craving of inadequate things, the debased substitutes for the truth that we seek. One word says it all. Isn't that great? It's the economy of Sanskrit, of Buddhist teaching, which is entirely consistent with Christian reasoning. So we should have known that the data were going to find this, I suppose. So the question then is, what do you do? What do you do? I gave you the data. Don't go searching after riches. Seek ye not riches. What should you do? The answer is sell everything and live like an impoverished monk, right? Right? Come on, right? It makes perfect sense. I took that question to a friend, a new friend that I made last year. See, I was in New Delhi, and it was actually after a visit to the Dalai Lama. And In New Delhi, I was visiting a very famous temple, a Hindu temple called the Temple Ashkardhan, and it's an incredible place. It took 10,000 artisans and stone cutters 7 full-time years to build this temple, and it's pretty new. It was only built about 15 years ago. The place is incredible. And it's just crawling with these monks in saffron robes, these sardhus, Hindu monks. And I was going to meet with one. His name was Swami Gyan Muni, right? I'm thinking, how good is his English going to be? And I meet him, and he comes up to me, and he says, "Are you Arthur?" in a Texas accent. I said, "This is really weird." I said, "Where are you from?" He said, "I'm from Houston." I said, "You're from Houston? What's your story?" I got to hear his story. I said, "What's your story?" He said, "Oh, yeah, people always ask me that." I said, "I wonder why." He said, I got my MBA after going to the University of Texas. I grew up in Houston because my dad was a petroleum engineer. It's really on my way to a big career. Got my MBA, went to work for McKinsey. I was doing consulting. I was making a lot of money. And I woke up one morning and I said, "Is this it? Is this all there is?" So I renounced it all. And I went to seminary. And I became a Hindu monk. It took me 7 years of study. But now, finally, I found what I'm looking for. And I said, "Well, you really renounced everything?" And he said, "Yeah, I have 4 possessions. 2 robes, prayer beads, and a bowl for my food. That's all I own." I said, "Really? So I got to ask you a couple of questions, because I'm this big free enterprise advocate. Tell me," I said, "your view on capitalism." Right? I want it straight up. I want to hear it from a guy who got an MBA and was going to make the big money, and then he renounced it all, and all he has is a couple of robes, some beads, and a bowl. I want to hear what he has to say about it. He said, "You know what he said? Poverty. Poverty is the reason we have to be capitalists, because free enterprise is the only great force against poverty in human history." Now, that blew my mind. I didn't think he was going to say that, right? "Really?" I said, well, don't you have strong views on money? Isn't money bad? Isn't that the point of your life? Isn't money bad?" He said, "Money isn't bad, no." He said, "The problem isn't money. The problem is attachment to money." Huh. Now, I should have known that, right? Really got me thinking. And here's why I should have known that, because I'm a Christian. St. Paul's first letter to Timothy. "For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." See, you always remember that, is that money is the root of all evil. You know that scripture? That's not what he says. Money's not the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. Swami Gyan Muni says it's the attachment to money, not the money itself. This is the secret. This is the secret that we have to understand. There's nothing wrong with free enterprise. There's nothing wrong with having stuff. Don't go sell the house and the car. Just don't love the house and the car. They're not your friends. They're not your family. And they're not God. The solution is detachment. Detachment from material things. That sounds really, really Eastern, right? That sounds really, really Buddhist. Detachment is what we need to do. But it's not Eastern, nor Western. It's human. You're Christians, and so am I. Remember, our Savior was born in absolute poverty in this world to teach us the lesson of detachment from worldly things. This is the first lesson of Christmas. It's amazing. And yet we forget it. And we listen to politicians who say, "The problem is that we have too much wealth, and it's creating too much inequality." And you hear people say that what we need to do is to impoverish ourselves, but they're wrong. We need to remember that detachment is the key. It's the first secret. Here's the formula. Remember the old formula, the worldly formula? Use people and love things. Turn it upside down. Make it virtuous. Love people. Use things. Only love people. Only use things. That's the secret. It's the first secret on how to become detached. But you need more practical wisdom than that, too. Because there's got to be a way to practice detachment. There has to be some way to become more detached through the practices of everyday life. And there are. The first one is charity. give away that which you hold dear. I talk to a lot of clergy. I talk to Catholic priests and Protestant ministers, and one of the questions I ask is, what does it mean to tithe? What does it mean to tithe? And they say, give away 10% of your money, right? And they argue. You know, my dad always gave away 10% gross, right? And I was like, that's crazy. Are you kidding? Got to give it away after taxes. And he said, no. And I said, how come, Dad? How come you got to give away 10% gross before taxes? You know what he said? Just in case. All right. Charity. But and when you ask people to what does tithing mean, and they talk about money, you say, well, really? What about the things that we treasure? Your time and your affection and your energy, your expertise. Aren't those things important too? Have you given away 10% of your time? Have you given away 10% of your affection? 10% of your friendship? The things that really are the resources that are the treasures in your life? If you do, you practice detachment. Because charity is the way that we can become unattached to the treasures that become our idols. How do I know it's a secret to success? Well, there's a lot of studies out there that show that it makes you healthy, happier, and even richer. I gave a BYU forum a few years ago. Wonderful experience. I had no idea how fun it was going to be. And even more, how long it was going to be sitting on BYU TV. Because, you know, I still get people sending me emails about that. And I looked at it. Somebody sent me the video, and I looked at it. And I was like, man, I have lost a lot of hair. And what do you find? I mean, there's a lot of literature out there. You get happy, healthy, prosperous if you give more. Here's my favorite study. This is a brand new study from the University of Liverpool. Okay, this is a study where men were asked to participate in a study with human respondents. They were supposed to bring their significant other, their girlfriends or wives, with them to the study. Okay, now, what was the study? It was real easy. Walk from this building to that building. Right now, and they would walk with their wives or girlfriends from one building to another, and there's an alleyway between the buildings, and when they got to the alleyway, a homeless guy would walk out and ask him for change. Right now, what was the point of the experiment? They got to the other building, and they would ask the people in isolation, how much money did you give to the man? And then to the woman, how much sex appeal does the man have? How attractive is the man? Right? What'd you find? The more he gave, the sexier his wife thought he was. Right? This is the secret, guys. That's right. This is the secret, right? Anyway, I mean, it's great. You'll get happier, healthier. You'll even be better looking if you give more money to charity. Detachment. It works. Okay, so that's the first way is charity. But there's another way to practice this, too. Have you ever seen that MasterCard ad where guys, there's a whole bunch of them that are just like this. You've seen them, where the guy's going to the beach. And he starts toting up how much it costs to get there. He says, beach ball, $3, right? Gas for the car, $36. An evening one night at the hotel at the beach, $136. A weekend away at the beach with my son, priceless. Right? Okay, stupid ad, but what's the point? The point is, focus on the value of experiences, not on the price of things. The value of experiences are rarely, rarely alone. They normally involve relationships. The price of things is just talking about stuff. The point of that ad is you got to shell out some money for stuff. Who cares? Who cares about the beach ball? Who cares about the gas? Who cares about the hotel? What I care about is the time with my son, right? Huh. You know, there's a comedian, the great, famous, neurotic comedian Woody Allen. He has this story that he used to tell that when he was married to his first wife, that, you know, is a dysfunctional marriage, you know, what are the odds? And he's saying that at one point they were really, really down on their luck. They didn't have much money left, and they had just enough money, right, either to have 2 weeks in Bermuda as a vacation or to pay for a divorce, right? And they couldn't decide which to do. So they decided ultimately on the divorce because the vacation is over in 2 weeks, but a divorce is something you have forever, right? Now, here's why that's wrong. Here's why that's wrong. Because experiences bring happiness. Things don't bring happiness. Things give you a temporary boost in mood. Experiences bring you true happiness. Now, this is counterintuitive. People always think, well, look, I could blow all my money on some vacation, or I could get a new car. A new car would be better because I'm going to have it forever. But no, it's wrong. The vacation is something you're going to remember forever. Lots of studies on this. I'm not going to bore you on it, but lots of laboratory experiments show that experiences are always a better investment than things. Here's how I learned it. I mean, I've known these things for a long time. I'm not sure I believed it. Here's how I knew it. 5 years ago, my middle son, his name is Carlos. He's 15. He's 14. He's turning 15. Carlos, when he was 9, I asked him, Carlos, what do you want for Christmas, buddy? And he said, I've been thinking about it. All I want this year, I don't want any stuff. All I want is to go away with you alone hunting and fishing. Right? Pretty nice, right? See, he doesn't know that that costs 19 times more than the stuff, right? But anyway, because he thought he was doing me a favor, right? All I want is to go away hunting and fishing with you. And I said, that's awesome. Let's do that. So we did. And we didn't just do it that one time. Now, he never gets anything for Christmas. Every year, we go hunting and fishing together between Christmas and New Year's. This year, we're going to go hunting wild boar and then light tackle fishing off the coast of Florida. Why do I tell you that? Because I can't wait. I'm really excited. I can't wait. And Carlos can't wait. We talk about it all the time. He can tell you every single trip that we've done, everything he's shot, everything he's caught, and he can show you the pictures of it, right? If I had been giving him the stuff 2 months after Christmas, he wouldn't remember even what I gave him. Oh, I think I got a bike. I don't know. A skateboard. I don't know, right? Oh, that's the time I shot that white-tailed deer. That's really cool, right? I'm doing the same thing with my other kids, too, but they don't all like to hunt. One of them likes to go to concerts. So we go to concerts together for his birthday. We go to New York and we go listen to concerts. He likes to go to concerts and museums, right? Go figure. I love that stuff too. It's great. That's how I learned it. Value of experiences, not the price of things. Here's how we get to experience that fact every day. Because again, this is detachment. Detachment from worldly physical things is getting the experience and having the value of the experience, which always revolves around the relationships with other people. Okay? Love people. Use things. How do we get to experience this a lot? The answer is work. The answer is with our work. When you have a job that you love, even a job that you just kind of like, why is it that it's so important to you? You might say, it's a living. I want the money. But that's not really the big thing. It's your identity. It gives your life meaning. It gives your life shape. This is a really big deal to people. This is the reason that, and this will explain a statistic I'm about to give you, that you're going to find surprising. What percentage of Americans like or love their jobs? Okay, get a number in your head. Just don't shout it out. Get a number in your head. What percentage of Americans say anonymously that they like or love their jobs? Okay, you got a number in your head? It's wrong. The number in your head is wrong. It's 89%. I know you thought it was lower, right? Everybody thinks I like my job, but everybody else hates theirs. Wrong. Wrong. The person who makes your sandwich tomorrow loves her job. The guy you see cutting a yard on the way home from school, he likes his job. Most likely. It doesn't vary with respect to amount of education. It doesn't vary with respect to income, believe it or not. 89% of Americans, what a blessing. What a wonderful thing. Why? Why is that? Why do 89% of Americans like or love their job? It's not the money. I only ruled money out by looking at it with respect to the neutralization of money in experiments. The answer is earned success. Earned success. The belief that you're creating value with your life and you're creating value in the lives of other people. When you believe that you're earning your success, you've found one of the great keys to happiness. It's an amazing thing. I have data from the University of Chicago. Take two people, same people, basically, statistically, same age, sex, race, religion, same region of residence, even the same level of education. They both feel that they've been very successful. They have earned their success. But one person earns 8 times as much as the second. They will be equally likely to say that they are very happy about their lives. Money doesn't buy happiness. Earned success through meaningful work is one of the great secrets to happiness. So what we need, what do we need? You need, and I need, to work in an apostolate that serves others and serves your values. Because that will bring you earned success no matter how much you make. You might make a lot, you might make a little. And furthermore, if we really want to serve others, even other people that we don't know, we got to have a system. We have to have a system in our economy that allows other people to earn their success. So what are the characteristics of an economic system where people can earn their success? Let me propose this. Number one, a system where people have their skills and their passions meet. where they're in a free labor market, where they can go find a job that more or less matches what they're good at and what they like. It's a system where merit and hard work are rewarded. Generally speaking, if you work harder, you make more money. If you're a better worker, you make more money. And you need a system where entrepreneurship and innovation are celebrated. You're not called stupid because you're working harder and trying to do something new. That's celebrated, right? You need a system that does those three things. And here's the best news. Here's the best news of the afternoon. That system exists, and it's called free enterprise. The American free enterprise system is a system that is almost literally a happiness machine for people. But wait. Right now, I hope you're a little bit skeptical right now, because I just said two things that are a little bit in conflict. I just told you right now that it's really good for bringing happiness, but haven't you heard your whole life that free enterprise and capitalism, they bring materialism, right? And materialism, loving things, is something I was complaining about a minute ago. So what's the story? You've been hearing your whole life that capitalism creates incentives to consume, to get ahead, to squash the other guy, to acquire a lot of possessions, and that's the secret to unhappiness, right? Now, related to this, we have a big national debate going on about inequality, income inequality. Some people have so much, and some people have so little, and people have so much they don't need it, and people have so little they don't like it, and this is creating lots of unhappiness in life, and that's a problem with free enterprise too. Wouldn't it be better for fighting materialism? Wouldn't it be better for inequality if we had less free enterprise? If you listen to the government in Washington, they say, yeah, that's right. That's right. More taxation, more redistribution, more regulation, less free enterprise. Well, think about this for a second. Let's think first about the nature of real materialism. You hear about inequality, right? If you're on the wrong side of income inequality, you're a victim. You're a victim of society. Is there anything that's more materialistic than that assertion? You really want, because you're making a low salary, let's say you work for a nonprofit organization. Your starting salary is $34,000 a year, right? And one of your buddies gets out of college and he's making $109,000 because he went to work for some consulting firm, right? You're on the wrong side of inequality. You're defined as a victim of society. Do you want to be a victim just because of the choices and circumstances of money? The worst thing that a politician can do is to debase the dignity of an individual by saying that that person is a victim on the basis of income inequality. Yet that's what politicians do all day long, fomenting class grievance and stripping the poor of the dignity that they deserve. That's the first thing to remember. But here's actually the big argument about this. You know, free enterprise makes people more materialistic, right? Have you ever been to a socialist country? Some of you have, right? Go to Cuba, go to Vietnam, or better yet, ask somebody what it was like behind the Iron Curtain back in the old Soviet Union days. You will never see more materialism than that. You'll never see more selfishness, more greed, more cheating, more corruption than you will find in socialist countries. Why? Because there's a scarcity mentality, because life is a zero-sum game. I'm going to get what's mine. That's what we find in socialist countries. The real problem, in a nutshell, is not the economic system when it comes to materialism, when it comes to selfishness, when it comes to avarice, when it comes to greed. The real problem is not economics. The problem is morality. The problem is humans acting badly. No system without the principles of brotherhood and service to a greater good will ever reflect virtue or bring about a good life. That's a fact. Don't let anybody sell you the snake oil that an economic system will perfect humanity, because it won't. I don't care if they tell you it's capitalism or they tell you it's socialism. You know, and I know, this starts with your virtue. This starts with your heart. This starts with your relationship with others and your service to God. That's where your morality begins, and that comes before economics. That's the real problem with selfishness. So before any discussion of materialism, we have to have a discussion about our morals. But once we do, if you have your morals in order, if you really have your act together, free enterprise is so much better than all the alternatives. It's ironic. If we love people and use things, if our morals are right, the system that brings the greatest wealth, which unambiguously free enterprise does, is also the system that can move us from materialistic misery to an exciting, happier life. It's the system where we can be set free to pursue the experience of earning our success. It's the system that with hard work, we can actually maybe create a little surplus and give it to our fellow men and women who are in need. So I'm almost done. But I want to reiterate the three secrets. Next time somebody says to me, or somebody says to you, I want to be happier, here's a little news that they can use. Here's a little practical information. Here's some tips for a happier life. Number one, remember the moral formula for a happy life. This is diagnostic. Go to an unhappy person. You will find they love things and use people. Go to a happy person. They love people and they use things. Don't forget it in your own life and give it to somebody else as well. That's number one. Number two, remember to reject materialism, embrace detachment. Don't get rid of material things. Make sure you're unattached, you're detached from material things. And the way to do that, the practices to do that are practicing charity. Give more away of what you hold dear and value experiences over things. And finally, number three, do you want to reject materialism? Are you ready to do it? Then you got to fight for a system. It's not good enough just to be virtuous yourself. You have to fight for a system that will, and always has, delivered earned success for everyone, which is the free enterprise system. If we do all these things together, this is our project. People are going to live better lives, and we're going to be happier people, and we're going to be able to pass on these secrets to people so they can live better lives as well. God bless you. Thank you. Yeah, we have time.
Yeah. My name's Chandler. I'm a social psychology major.
Uh-huh.
I was a freshman when you need to form back in 09.
Terrific.
I'm a fifth year senior now.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. So my question is, in your last form and even now you talk about giving back and having lived in Washington for the last few years, what are the ways that you've been able to get involved out there and give back and fulfill that part of your life?
So thank you, Chandler. How do you give back even when you live in the venal, rough and tumble world, the greedy world of Washington, D.C.? You know, in a way, it's easier. It's a target-rich environment. There's a lot to do. Almost any place you go, I mean, you're going to be involved in your church, and you're going to tithe your income, and you're going to find people who actually need your message and to whom you can dedicate a non-trivial amount of the things that you hold dear. So the good news is basically this. It doesn't matter where you are. You're going to be around people in need. The only difference is in some places they know they're in need, and some other places they don't know they're in need. Right? You know this all the time. The problem with Washington, D.C. is, boy, are they needy. The problem is they just don't know it. Right? So you have to help them. You have to find, and how do you do that? Well, part of your tithe, I should say, part of the way that you can give back is with the witness, with the torch of your life. Okay? That's a really, really important thing. Remember, people are watching how you live your life. It's funny, you know. I have a lot of colleagues and friends, LDS friends in Washington, D.C. It's not as normal to be Mormon in Washington as it is in Utah. Newsflash, right? Right. So the key thing is that people are watching you disproportionately. See, I hang out a lot with political liberals. You know, I write for the New York Times. And this is a politically liberal environment. It's the same kind of thing. I'm a political conservative, right? Duh, I guess you kind of figured that one out already, right? What's the witness? The witness is most people I hang out with have never met a conservative, so it's a higher responsibility on me to act in a particular way that is this form of service, of making sure I act right. It's weird. I told the story at the forum. I probably haven't told it since, of this experience that I had where you guys here at BYU, you taught me this lesson. You don't even know it, right? Because I had this thing. It's this story that came back to me a bunch of times. It was a story that I had, I would call it my magic briefcase story, right? So I was here years ago before I did a forum. You know, I come back all the time. The guy who used to be the dean of the business school, a guy named Gary Cornea, he says, you're our favorite Catholic, right? So I gave a speech one time, and I was leaving, and they gave me a souvenir. They gave me a BYU briefcase. Right, BYU briefcase. And I didn't need a briefcase, so I got home and I put it away. And about 6 months later, my briefcase that I was carrying, the handle tore off. And I said, oh, man, the handle came off my briefcase. And my wife, she said, why don't you get that one they gave you in Utah? I said, oh, okay. So I got it out, and it said BYU. It says, I don't know. It says BYU on it. She says, what are you, chicken? What are you afraid of, right? I said, okay, fine, right? I'm up for a challenge. So I put all my stuff in it, and I started carrying it around. And I'm in airports all the time because I'm traveling constantly. And I noticed this really weird thing, which is every time I'm in an airport and I'm holding the briefcase, no matter where I am and somebody looks at you, they look at your briefcase and they read it, and then they look up at you. They're going, ah, it's a Mormon guy, right? Now, it's false advertising a little bit because I'm actually Catholic, right? And so I'm thinking that's, you know, funny that they kind of, but I noticed something that as my behavior was getting better, right? Why? Because I didn't want to besmirch your reputation as LDS, right? I didn't want people to think, I saw this Mormon guy. He didn't look much like a Mormon. He kind of looked like this, you know, aging hipster weirdo, right? He didn't look like a Mormon. But I know he's a Mormon because he had a BYU briefcase and he was acting like a real jerk, right? I didn't want it, you know, hurt your reputation.
So
your briefcase made me into a better person. This is part of witnessing. Part of witnessing is people are going to look at you, they're going to learn about you, and they're going to say, you know, I know that Mormon, and he's really, really a good person. That is a form of charity, how you live your life. If people see me and they say, yeah, but he's a really serious Catholic, and he's a really good person, he takes it seriously, that's a form of using your life as witness, your basic life as witness. And this is, I think, the most important takeaway that I've learned from coming to Washington, D.C. And I learned it from you. Thank you. All right, one more. Sorry, I went on a little bit longer on that one, but you had to hear about my famous briefcase.
So do you think there's any hope for our government? Do you think they'll ever see that free enterprise is the correct way to go?
Yeah. Yeah, so is there any hope for the government? So two questions. Is there any hope for the government, and will they ever see that free enterprise is the right way to conduct our national policies, right? So the answer is not entirely. Why? Because government has an incentive to not like free enterprise. Government is the opposite of free enterprise ordinarily. It's command and control. Now, I don't think we shouldn't have a government. I'm glad we have a government. I think we need taxation and regulation, system of the provision of public goods, yada, yada, yada. You agree with me, I know, and you know, we all think these things. The problem is the government doesn't exist to not do things. Government doesn't exist to let the free enterprise system provide things privately. Government is in the business of intervening in the private economy. So there's a tension. Now I'm going to do a thing, and Rachel here is live tweeting this event, or at least taking pictures. She's going to grab me, and we're going to go down to Salt Lake City, and I'm going to do an event with your senator, Mike Lee. He's great, because he's one of the guys in government who totally gets this. He believes in free enterprise. Why? Because here, you believe in this, and you elected him. Congratulations, good job, right? But not everybody has these values. So it's not realistic to think that the government's going to say, you know, wow, happiness and free enterprise, they go together like peanut butter and chocolate, man. So let's do this more. It's not realistic to do it. And that puts the onus of responsibility on you and me as citizens to make sure that we can elect as many people who have these values, doesn't matter if they're Democrats or Republicans, who reflect these values as much as possible, and we militate for them in the values that we reflect for the rest of society. It's really up to us to make sure that they don't go too far. I guess we have time for one more, or maybe two, depending on how fast it is, and I'll try to keep my answer short.
Hi, my name is Patience, and I'm a freshman, and I'm looking into actuarial science. And I'm just wondering of different variations of responses you get when you tell your philosophy to different people who are atheists or aren't sure of their faith or agnostic.
So that's a good question. What happens when you explain how you see the world to people? You're going to be facing this your whole life, right? I mean, maybe, thank you, Patience, maybe you won't leave your community, right? But I recommend that you do. Get out of the house, right? Like, just, you know, never leaving your faith community, never leaving the community of people who agree with you, you know, that's actually biblical. That's keeping your candle under the bed, under the bushel basket, right? Don't do that. You have an opportunity to get out there, and once again, with your own little version of the magic briefcase, bringing a little bit of light to the world. So I kind of mixed my metaphors there, but you get my point, right? So how do people react? How are they going to react? Well, it depends on you. Really depends on you. I'm never, never ridiculed for my faith. well, almost never. I don't read the comments after my columns in the New York Times. I'm sure there's plenty of ridicule about that. But, you know, nobody ever comes up to me and said, how stupid is it? What a weird cult that you have. What a bunch of weird beliefs. Why? Because people actually are pretty decent out there. Now, they're not going to necessarily embrace it. They're going to say, wow, Arthur Brooks, he's a serious Christian, so I think I'm going to go be a serious Christian too. Maybe some have. But that's not the ordinary reaction. What you're trying to do is you're trying to move somebody a few inches. They get proximity to you. They have a conversation with you. They hear you say something, and they move a few inches over. They say, yeah, that's actually not so bad. Because you move them over 3 inches, and another 3 inches, and another 3 inches, and then magic happens, right? Magic is all sort of incremental in this way. I have never had a bad experience from this. Nothing but good experiences. Now, are some people going to be thinking I'm crazy? Yeah, maybe I am. Maybe, you know, this is the funny thing about Christianity. It makes you a little nuts, in a good way, right? But it's not a problem, and it's really a blessing. It's really a blessing. You have time for one more? We got to go. God bless you, and thank you, and good luck with your
thank
year.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, thanks.